So good morning class. Today we are going to discuss new chapter, chapter number 2, which is inverse trigonometric functions. So first of all, you all have learned about the trigonometric functions, and in chapter 1 also you have studied about the inverse of functions. So if it is a trigonometric function, then we can also find the inverse of that, right? But what are these trigonometric functions? First of all, let us define. First function is sine function, which is from R to minus 1 to 1. That means the domain is real number and the codomain is interval minus 1 to 1. Next trigonometric function is cosine, whose domain is R to minus 1 to 1. That means our codomain is interval minus 1 to 1. Next function is tangent, which is whose domain is R minus all those x such that x is 2n plus 1 pi by 2, such that n belongs to z. Now what is this? Why these are not included in the domain? Because at all these points tangent is not defined, right? So if tangent is not defined, they will not come in the domain. So that's why they are excluded from the domain, and the codomain is set of real numbers. And similarly, cotangent, secant and cosecant, all these are trigonometric functions. Now if these are trigonometric functions, these are the functions, then we can find the inverse of that functions. But what is the condition for inverse? You all know, in the chapter 1 we discussed that for the inverse of any function, we need is function should be bijective. That means function must be 1-1 and onto. But we all know that these all the functions are not 1-1 and onto in the given domain and range. So if they are not 1-1 and onto they can be, but I don't think it will be 1-1. It is not 1-1, right? So we can say that these functions are not bijective. So if these functions are not bijective, so how we can find the inverse of them? So if we have to find the inverse of them, first of all we have to make them 1-1 and onto. So to make them 1-1 and onto, we restricted the domain of the trigonometric functions. So what we did in the restriction of domain, we restricted the domain of sine from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 from real numbers to make it bijective, right? So this function now became sine, by the restriction of domain, minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 to minus 1 and 1. Next is cosine. We restricted the domain to 0 to pi closed interval to minus 1 to 1. We restricted the domain from R to 0 to pi. Next is tangent function, which is restriction of domain with minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 open interval to R. Earlier it was R minus all those numbers such that it will be equals to 2n plus 1 pi by 2, where n belongs to integer. So now we restricted the domain to open interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 to make it bijective. Same is the case for cotangent. We restricted the domain to 0 to pi open interval. For secant, we restricted the domain to 0 to pi excluding pi by 2. Why excluding pi by 2? Because secant was such a function that it whose domain was real numbers excluding that point, which are 2n plus 1 pi by 2. So it will be including pi by 2 also. So pi by 2 must be excluded from the domain of secant, so that secant must be defined. So at pi by 2, secant is not defined. So to make it defined, we excluded pi by 2 from the domain. Next is cosecant. Cosecant is taken as minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 excluding 0. Why excluding 0? Same reason, because cosecant is not defined at 0. So to make it defined on all the points of domain, we excluded 0 from the domain. And the range is, or codomain is, same. So now all these functions are 1-1 and onto. You all can check it, that these all the functions with the restriction of domain became bijective functions. So if these became bijective functions, so we can find the inverse of them. So if we can find the inverse of them, all of you know that if f is a function from x to y and f is bijective, then f inverse will be a function from y to x. So if it will be a function from y to x, then how sine inverse will be defined? Sine inverse will be defined from minus 1 to 1 to minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. And one thing more, this is not a unique restriction. We can restrict the domain of these trigonometric functions in other ways also, but this is what, this is the principal branch for the restriction of domain. That is why we have written here principal branch. So this is the principal branch of restriction of domain. We can restrict it in many ways, but we are taking just the principal branch, right? So now what will be the sine inverse for the principal branch? It will be minus 1 to 1 to minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. Same is the case for cos inverse. It will be minus 1 comma 1 to 0 to pi. Same tan inverse will be from r to minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 open interval. Same cot inverse will be from r to 0 to pi open interval. Same for secant inverse and cosecant inverse also. So these are all the six functions with their inverses, right? So how these inverses came? By taking the principal branches. And all these are what? All these are principal branches of trigonometric functions, inverse trigonometric functions. So these are the branches we took for the inverse functions, and now they are defined, so we can find the value of any number under this function, inverse function. We can take any number between minus 1 to 1 and we can find the image of that under sine inverse. So these type of problems are there. They are saying find the principal value of sine inverse 1 by root 2. Now they are saying principal value. The principal value means that it must be in the principal branch. Otherwise sine inverse 1 by root 2 can have many values, or we can say infinite values, because all of you know that sine repeats after every 2 pi interval, right? So if sine inverse 1 by root 2, it will be taking many values, infinite number of values, but they are saying to find the principal value. That means we have to take the value of only principal branch, right? Now what is the procedure to solve this type of question? We have to find the sine inverse 1 by root 2. So let us take it as some value y. Let y be equal to sine inverse 1 by root 2. Now apply sine function on both the sides. We will get sine of y will be equal to sine of sine inverse of 1 by root 2, which will be equal to 1 by root 2. Now we got is what? We got sine y equals to 1 by root 2. Now 1 by root 2 we can write it as sine of pi by 4, because we have to compare both. So if we have to compare both, both must be same quantities. One is constant, other is a function. So we have to make both the quantities same. We made it as sine function only. So we can write 1 by root 2 as sine of pi by 4. So we written it as sine of pi by 4. This gives us y equals to pi by 4. Now we have to check whether this value lies in our principal branch or not. Now you can check our principal branch is what? Minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. And pi by 4 lies in the principal branch. So if this lies in the principal branch, this is what? This is the principal value of sine inverse 1 by root 2. We took y as sine inverse 1 by root 2 and we got the value of y as pi by 4. That means our principal value of sine inverse 1 by root 2 was pi by 4. Next question, next and last question we will discuss. All your first exercises based on these types of question only. You all must try this question. Now next type is find the principal value of cot inverse minus 1 by root 3. Now all your concept will be cleared from this type of question. This says we have to find the principal value of cot inverse minus 1 by root 3. We will follow the same procedure. We will take it as y. So we will get cot y equals to minus 1 by root 3. Now we have to compare both the sides, right? We can compare only if both the sides will be same. This is a function, this is a constant. So if we have to take the constant as function, we can write it as negative of negative as it is, negative of cot pi by 3. cot pi by 3 you all know is what? 1 by root 3. So if it is minus of cot pi by 3, one way is we can take the negative inside, because all of you know that cot of minus x is always equals to negative of cot x. So we can take the negative inside as well. So cot y will be equals to cot of minus pi by 3. This gives us y is equals to minus pi by 3. So now check whether the y lies in our principal branch. So now our principal branch for cot inverse will be was 0 to pi open interval. But we are getting the value as minus pi by 3, which does not lies in our principal branch. So we have to find another value which will be such that cot y equals to minus cot pi by 3. Same, right? Now we have to do is we have to make certain changes in the right hand side to make the value in our principal branch, right? Now we can do is what? We know that cot is negative in our second quadrant. So if it is negative in second quadrant, we can apply the quadrant system, and we all know that cot of pi minus theta is always equals to minus of cot theta. So if this property holds, then we can write minus of cot pi by 3 as cot of pi minus pi by 3, which will be equals to cot of 2 pi by 3. On simplifying this, we will get cot of 2 pi by 3. Now cot y is equals to cot 2 pi by 3, that means our y is equals to 2 pi by 3. Now see, this value 2 pi by 3 lies in our principal branch. So this value is our principal value of cot inverse minus 1 by root 3. So this was our whole topic for today. We will discuss it in class as well. So you must try all the questions of first exercise which are based on this type of question. Thank you.